All right. How are we doing today? I'm doing fine, absolutely. Start things off, let's ask a question here. When is the last time you saw on television, on movies, and popular entertainment, news, what, anyone who's in the public eye on television, when is the last time you saw anyone wearing a Christian cross, except for obvious programs that are produced on Christian channels, Christian broadcasting networks, etc., obviously. Other than that, when is the last time you saw anyone wearing a Christian cross on television, movies, etc.? This is very interesting. The Holy Spirit put this question to me yesterday. The idea came to me. They said, "Hey, when have I last seen a Christian cross on TV?" I said, "Oh, let me think." I said, "Huh? Wait, let me think again." I couldn't remember, and then I realized that commercials. Check out the commercials. When is the last time you saw anyone in a commercial wearing anything depicting Christianity? Anything depicting Christianity at all? Isn't the country like 80% Christian or something like that? So wouldn't in a diverse, tolerant society that, you know, reflects the makeup of a country, wouldn't you have then, you know, 80% of the people maybe be depicting Christianity or something like that? I mean, wouldn't that be diversity, proper diversity? So I wonder if you can even remember when you last seen a cross. I can't remember at all. And I started looking at TV. I said, "Wait a minute, let me take a look here. I so far haven't seen a single one." And of course, there's all these ladies in commercials all wearing necklaces. You know, never do you see a Christian cross, and never do you see it. Or it's just circumstance, right? Happenstance. There's no intention behind this, of course. You know, like in commercials, there's no intention. Everything's just kind of haphazard and circumstantial in commercials, right? There's no producer, you know, deciding various things. It's just a couple of people get together with some cameras and have some fun, something like that. Or maybe there is a producer who's watching every last detail of the commercial. Maybe that's the way it is. So, wardrobe assistant, continuity assistant, detail assistant, etc., etc. Every last little thing, down to the airbrushing on all the models, you know, the making them look exactly the way they want to look. And yeah, and no Christian crosses anywhere. No Christian, nothing relating to Christianity whatsoever. And so I saw that and I said, that's quite funny. Quite funny. Quite funny indeed. And, you know, what's going on right now in the world? All these programs, I know CNN's got some big, you know, thing on Jesus, and there's all these magazines with Jesus. It's been going on for quite some time now. Like an obsession. They're obsessed with, is Jesus real or a fake? Is there a historical Jesus or not? You know, no archaeological evidence. Maybe this might. Mary Magdalene, yes, did Mary have children? And, you know, they're obsessed with the historical Jesus. Trying to throw all sorts of stuff up in the air, you know, and make it so confusing. Wonder why they're doing all of that. I can laugh because I know the answer to all this. They're so desperate. You know, it's like they're freaking out about Jesus. Those who can't stand Jesus are the ones who are freaking out about it. You know, just having to pull all these scholars in with all these conflicting opinions, you know, and so you're watching this and you get just overloaded and confused and say, I don't know. So I've been doing some Bible study lately, actually. And, you know, here's a question. Well, in his farewell testament, okay, the New Testament. Testament is actually something that you give on your deathbed, basically. And your final statement, the New Testament. You just gave a New Testament. Well, the farewell testament in John, okay, the Gospel of John. Jesus says, you know, before, he says, you're no longer slaves. I now call you friends. Don't look at yourself as slaves. I call you friends. And he reiterated this very strongly, that we should view one another friend to friend, friend to friend, friend to friend. This is his testament before, that was just before he was then tried and crucified. So, and I've been saying that Jesus is back. He's actually back, and as a friend, as a friend. So his final farewell testament was, look, this is how you need to see me. This is how I see you. And if you see someone as a friend, that means you're their friend and they are your friend, equals. So he says, I'm basically saying, he's saying, I see you as equals. So you've got to focus on this. Okay. Now that's what I focused on in my life. I said, I've got to get to the point where I can see Jesus as a friend, because that's how he sees us. Not as an idol, not as some pagan god or anything like that, as a friend, a brother in spirit. And this is how Jesus has presented himself as he prepared for his comeback here, through A Course in Miracles. He absolutely stressed that we're all equal, and he does not want to be worshipped or idolized at all. And that's extremely inappropriate for any of the sonship to try and worship any of the other sonship. It's not appropriate at all. And so he's been preparing us for this, to see him as a friend. So now that Jesus is actually here, what do you think Jesus cares about? Jesus cares about, have we been listening to his teaching? Have we followed his teaching? The Last Supper, he's called himself the bread of life in John. I am the bread of life come from heaven. He said, my body is the teachings. The flesh profiteth nothing. What gives eternal life is the teachings I'm giving you. So the bread of life means the teachings that he's giving us, and he expected us to listen to those teachings, and salvation and eternal life comes from what? From hearing and accepting the teachings of Jesus. It's the teachings that he brought which will give us eternal life, not make us a new creation in God, but remind us of what's already the case. Remind us what's already true. And only our spiritual arrogance is hiding this from us. Spiritual arrogance makes us blind, makes us blind. So what do you think Jesus cares about? Does he care about that we're fighting over his historical relics, and somebody's got an ossuary box, you know, says James on it, and fighting over this? Is that what Jesus wants to come back to? Or does he want to come back to those who say, hey, I have repented from my arrogance. Welcome, friend. I'm so delighted that you're here. And I love your teachings. Just absolutely love your teachings. I want to hear more and more and more and more and more. And let's repent more and more and more and more. And let's hear it. Let's hear it, you know. What's he want to come back to? You see, this is what's funny, is they're so desperate to drag all these red herrings, throwing, they're just throwing everything up in the air right now, just hoping something will stick. You know, they're so desperate, which is rather silly. But it doesn't work. You know, those who have not repented have not repented. Those who have repented to a certain extent. I mean, path of repentance is somewhat gradual. You gradually shed the blindness of arrogance. Arrogance makes us blind. Spiritual arrogance makes us blind to the truth. And of course, the idea that only those who have, you know, accepted Jesus' teachings will be, the idea of Christianity is a little bit, they have a little bit of trouble there with the idea that those who accept Jesus' sacrificial atonement, some say that his teachings, will be saved. On the last judgment, God will pass them over, so to speak. You know, the whole idea of the Passover meal, the Last Supper, with the symbology of Passover, Jesus being the Lamb of God, which is comes from Judaism, in their fleeing, the Exodus from Egypt, where they put the blood of lambs over their doors, and that the wrath of the Lord, that was a plague that was coming upon the Egyptians, the 10th plague, which was killing all the firstborn males, I believe, passed over every door that had the blood of a lamb on it, and that where they were saved all their firstborns, and they left in a big hurry. The idea is somehow is that those who accept Jesus, the blood of Jesus, will, God's wrath of final judgment will pass over them, and they'll be saved from it. But God will annihilate all the others. You know, this is not so. This is absolutely not so, because everyone is in the perfect love of God right now and can never leave it. It's impossible. It's their arrogance that makes them blind to it. Okay, blind to this fact. And they have no choice but to ultimately repent and set that arrogance down. And they will continue in their arrogance until they do this. That's all. There is no final judgment. God created everything perfect, all perfectly empowered with perfect freedom and perfect love and perfect pure spaciousness. And that's it. There's been no change whatsoever. There never will be. There's no judgment at all from God. It's impossible for the Son of God to sin against God or sin against itself. Spirit cannot sin against itself. It's impossible. All the laws of God are still perfect, and we are still completely supported by all by the laws of God. We haven't done anything. Haven't changed it. Haven't done anything at all. That's the fact. So, being saved by Jesus means listening to his teachings and repenting. And this is what restores your awareness to the fact of eternal life. So when Jesus comes back, and he's already here, now that he is back, actually, what does he want to relate with those who have repented? You know, let's say you have a sibling, and unfortunately the sibling is mentally challenged to the point that their mind is scrambled, you know, and they can't communicate at all. And you know, you look at that sibling and say, oh, all I really want in my life, I just want to be able to communicate with my dear sibling. You know, I just want to be able to communicate back and forth, and I can't do it because their mind is all scrambled. So just think of Jesus. What does he want? He wants us, our minds to be unscrambled. We want to divest ourselves of the scrambling of arrogance, the logic of arrogant deviation. We want to get the load off our mind. Logic of arrogant deviation. Get a load off our mind, because it makes us blind. It confuses us. It turns us into whimsical, you know, farcical, nonsensical, confused, you know, maniacs, actually, in terms of our logic and thinking. And he can't, you know, he can't just enjoy the relating that you would want to relate with a brother or sibling, a sister, you know. He that's not happening. So that's all he wants. That's all it's all about. That's what it's all about. It's not about anything else. So certainly he's looking to relate. Looking for those who want to relate, who can relate. Yes, you know, he would like to just be able to relate. And so that's what we've been working on here. Working on the essentials of relationship, being able to relate. Relationship, relating one to another, relating. And in our arrogance, we're not able to relate to spiritual truth. The truth consciousness, we're not able to recognize it, see it, we fear it, we disdain it, we misrepresent it, we attack it, we distort it. We do all the kind of stuff that the entertainment and media, etc., are trying to do with Jesus. Twist, distort, confuse, bring fear and all this kind of stuff, you know. And, you know, they point out discrepancies here and discrepancies there. So I've been brushing up on my Bible study the last couple of days, actually. And it's been a big help to just, you know, not feel intimidated by all this nonsense that's going on. Because it's the teachings of Jesus that matter. Whether he was born in, you know, 4 B.C., 5 B.C., or, you know, 0, year 0, or 1 A.D., or, you know, it's, you know... whether, you know, Herod, you know, tried to kill the infants in Bethlehem under 2 years of age, 2 and under, something like that, or not. You know, all this historical stuff, you know, they're trying to get you to lose your mind and all that kind of stuff, because it's all hazy and ambiguous and uncertain, right? Whereas the fact of Jesus' teaching is crystal clear, unambiguous, very direct. And that's where our attention should be right now. That's where our attention should be. Because you can argue over the Bible for, I mean, people have been arguing over it for 2,000 years, actually. And it's only recently that we have been able to really dig into it to a much greater extent. And it's brought up some inconsistencies, for sure. Like, when was the Last Supper? You know, was it on a Wednesday or a Thursday? Or was it on a Friday? Yeah, the questions are... John, I think, says, well, it's on a Wednesday night. And the other synoptic gospels say it was on a Thursday night. Let's obsess about that. Or when was Jesus born? You know, and Herod died in like 4 BC, Herod the Great, 4 BC. And they said that he was born during the year Herod, because they had to flee to Egypt to avoid, you know, getting killed or something. And so it's easy to Luke has some stuff, you know, Luke has some inconsistencies. And you can start, you know, seeing that the historical record, the clear historical record, is somewhat fuzzy about, but the main pieces are there. The main pieces are there. And the most important thing is what's his New Testament? I'm coming back. What's his testament? You know, as he's being crucified and resurrected, and what does he say on the Olivet Discourse or the Mount of Olives, talking about the end times? Okay, he goes up on the Mount of Olives, which is just outside of Jerusalem, just to the east, and the apostles are there, and they say, "Tell us, you know, how's it going to go, you know, in the future?" And he says, "Well," and he gives them a nice talk and tells them all these things, and says, "No, don't worry. There are many rooms in my Father's mansion. If it weren't so, I would have told you. And I'm going there to prepare a place for you, and then to come back for you, and so that those who want can come and dwell with me there. You know, be not disturbed. All right. So there's a nice testament right there. So what's the testament? He's coming back. You know, that's very different than most testaments, the deathbed testaments. He's coming back, not only being resurrected, coming back to this world at the end of the age, where this is the end of the age right now, and he is back. Jesus is back. This is why the secular society is obsessed with Jesus right now. They're trying to confuse the issue, trying to confuse things as much as possible. So we're afraid of Jesus. Say, "Ah, Jesus, I'm not really sure what year you were born in, you know, 2,000 years ago, and so I'm really all confused. I'm afraid to talk with you, and, you know, and how can you prove this? Can you prove this? It's so important. Can you prove, you know, can you give me accurate account? How many miracles did you do? 37, or were there more? John said there were many more, and, you know, what happened here? What happened there? And now let me, you know," and you can get lost in all of that stuff. All of that stuff. And so many Christians, I think they obsess over Bible study and can make sure that they say, "This is Mark 4, you know, and he said exactly this here," and then, okay. Well, how about understanding, you know, accepting what Jesus had to say? And he's been augmenting this lately over the last, almost 40 years, actually, helping us pick up the pace. He says, "Hey, you're not doing so good. I need to give you, you know, one last push here." And looking at the Bible and history, you can see that people didn't understand it really at all. You know, they thought he was the Messiah, the line of David to restore the Davidian kingdom and defeat the Romans, really, right? That's what they wanted. Because at that time, Judea was now a province of Rome. It was a province of Rome. The Herodian king, King Herod the Great, and then the Tetrarchy, the four that were ruling the various areas, the one in Judea was banished from there. Archelaus, Herod Archelaus was banished in AD 6 or 7, something like that. And they said, Rome said, heck, we're making this Judea, a province with Samaria and Judea and Idumea. And so Pilate was the governor there at that time and started taxing. They were under tax, and the Jews started getting really upset. And they'd always been told that a great king would come, a great warrior king, would defeat all their enemies and restore the glory of the kingdom of David. So Jesus was supposed to be that Messiah. Yeah, but he didn't do that. He said he didn't do that. He said that my kingdom is not of this world. So there are little interesting tidbits, here and there and stuff, clearing stuff up. And they're arguing about did Mary have other children or not. It's like as if she did, that would like destroy Jesus or something, like the whole invalidate. They're trying to invalidate. Invalidate what? He's here right now. How can he be invalidated? He's already given out pure, pure, pure teachings in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, for instance, which make it very clear what he's saying. So, what does it do with arguing about whether Mary had or they had brothers, where Jesus had brothers and sisters? What? How does that invalidate anything, actually? I mean, it just there's some dogma of Mary being a perpetual virgin and stuff like that, but how does that invalidate Jesus? See, it's amazing. It's humorous. I'm laughing a lot because we need to. This is a silly time. There's a lot of silliness going on right now. So we can just roll with it. We just roll with it. We because Jesus is here now, it maybe it's worth brushing up a little bit on your Bible study if you want to. But don't get lost in it. Don't get lost in it. Just so you can't be pushed around too much. If they start throwing a bunch of funny stuff at you, you know what they're doing. And then they struggle about the doctrines and all this stuff about through all the churches and did this happen? How did this happen? I mean, it is just like a swamp. History is just a swamp. But what do we need to wallow in a swamp for when we have Jesus's ongoing testimony? I mean, the story of Jesus, his history, is ongoing, actually. It didn't stop with the crucifixion. It's ongoing. Mary Magdalene, she goes, look, checks the tomb, the stone is rolled away. She goes back to tell the disciples, and then Mary's mother and two of her friends come and see it, and they go back to tell a couple of the apostles, and they come, John and someone else, I think, and they come and look, and then, there's angels are telling them, the testimony of some angels is gone. And then on the way back, Mary Magdalene, I guess Jesus appears to her going back to Jerusalem. It's a short walk from Golgotha there, where the tomb is, that area. And then Jesus starts appearing. I think he appeared about 11 times altogether. He appears to a couple of apostles on the road to Emmaus, and then he appears various places. Sea of Galilee, he was on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. We can dial up that one, actually. If this goes through, maybe it doesn't. And so after he was crucified, he resurrected the body and is showing up to people, which means that his history continues. His history continues. There you go. Sea of Galilee. This is actually a painting of Jesus appearing on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. I'm not sure what city was near, whether west coast of Sea of Galilee, the east shore, west shore, east shore. But maybe, he was said, hey, did you catch any fish? And they said, no. He said, cast your net on the right side of the boat. And they caught all this fish, and Peter saw it was Jesus, and they came ashore, and he had a fire, and they're sitting down, they're talking. So his history continues, actually. Jesus' history didn't stop. Okay, he says, don't worry, I'm coming back. There will be an end of the age. It'll be terrible beyond your belief. I can't even explain it to you. And how could he explain this artificial intelligence that's come into the world, and the Orwellian crackpot thinking that's taking place here in this world is just it's farcical, actually. So how could he have explained that? He just said, look, there's going to come a time when there's very evil and adulterous generation. And we certainly are in that, and even the pressure will be so severe. Even the saints, even those who have repented, will be in danger of backsliding into arrogance, and we're certainly at that point. So his history continues. It continues. It continues. It continue with him impressing upon the mind of Helen Schuckman, she of Columbia University, New York. Who took down in shorthand the impressions that she was getting as ideas translated into words, which her and William Tedford then put together as A Course in Miracles, and saying, and Jesus very plainly saying, this is the author of the course, this is Yeshua, which is, I guess, his name back then would be termed Yeshua. Jesus is what? Is that a Roman or Greek or Greco-Roman rendition of Yeshua? And so then he also was able to speak somehow internally to Dr. Brent Haskell, and he transcribed it onto tapes, and that became a Journey Beyond Words and The Other Voice, which was a sort of a boiling down of the essence of A Course in Miracles for those who had already become very familiar with it, like a postgraduate course in miracles. And then he's been relating to those. I know for me, he's been relating with me since the 70s, late 70s, when I started A Course in Miracles in 1978. I had numerous dreams with Jesus, and we were relating, and he was conveying to me the need, urgent need to go as fast as you can and give it every amount of effort you can. It's very, very important. These are very urgent times, and you must not get caught up in the left. You must not get caught up in the conceptual, dualistic type of counting and accounting, and how many of this and that, and what's the number of the line, and can I quote this, and all these memorization, scholastic, academic aspects. They said, don't get caught up in any of that stuff, which I'd already decided not to because I dropped out of college. I said, I'm never going to succeed at what I want to do if I keep pursuing an academic career. And he just said, just get the essence, get the essence, get the essence, get the feel of it, get the feel of it. So that's what I've done. Try to just get the feel of it. Get the essence of it and boil it down. Simplify, simplify. So Jesus has been appearing in dreams and relating from time to time, and then there was a long gap for a while, and now he's been returned to relate, and the latest one was he said, I'm back here now. So officially he's back. And so all this preparation that he's helping us with was because he's returning. Now, I guess someone asked him back in the Course in Miracles back some time ago, I guess someone who may have been able to said they were relating with him asked him, maybe, are you returning? Or he says, well, I have no plans at this time. And he sort of brushed off the question, brushed off the question. Because it did not want us focusing on that. Really, he wants us focusing on the teaching. And you have to absorb that. You have to absorb it to the point where you're familiar with it. Now, is he back only for Christians? He's back for anyone who can relate to him, anyone who can relate with him as a friend. This could be any pathway you take that leads to truth. You can relate with Jesus because truth is one. Truth is one. Non-dual, any non-dual path, so to speak, you can certainly relate with Jesus. The total abstraction of truth, where there's no exception whatsoever to truth, absolutely none. If your mind is able to accept this and not fight against it, then you can certainly relate with Jesus. It's not like he's going to quiz you. You know, it's not like, okay, how's your Bible study been? And can you qu quote chapter and verse? He's not going to ask you to quote chapter and verse of anything. He told me, forget quoting chapter and verse. Forget it. I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in being able to parrot back something out of any book. He says, do you have the essence of it? Are you comfortable with the essence of the teaching? Are you comfortable with recognizing the defenses and the projection that we use and how we defend our arrogance and try to camouflage it and how all we have to do is repent and how God is perfect love and we're not in any contest with God. It's impossible to be annihilated. God can never be angry. There's no need for any sacrificial atonement. There's no need for any alignment. We're all perfectly aligned with pure spaciousness, with pure love, with pure perfect freedom. We can never be out of alignment. How can perfect freedom be out of alignment ever? With what? With what? With what? So these are the this is the time that we live in. It's a very good time, and maybe we'll. I mean, make some jokes. I mean, I'll maybe drop some jokes about Bible history. It can be a very humorous sort of thing, and maybe he'll clear some up. Maybe not. I don't know. Maybe it's a hornet's nest. You go in there. You know, there's like every scholar's aligned in every possible position. I don't want to encourage people too much to obsess about that. They're already obsessed. But you know, the idea that if you just say, "Hey, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus," I can recite the Gospel of Mark or something, or do you understand the essence of the teaching of what I brought to you, the spiritual teaching that brings that awakens you from the dream of death and why you chose death? And for instance, the crucifixion. Do you understand the crucifixion? What I was doing there actually is showing you your perfect freedom. You're even perfect. Everyone's equally free. Even said, even I am equally free to do experience anything I want to experience. So if I want to experience crucifixion, I'm free to do so. God's not going to stop me. Proving God's impartiality, proving that God has not changed in the slightest bit to us, right? Proved it to us. And all the miracles that he was part of, associated with, was proving that we're all perfectly free and we've never been bound. We're of the now. We're in the now, but not of it. We're in the now, but not of it. We can change our experiencing instantly. Nobody is bound by any process whatsoever. No dynamic binds us whatsoever. Time, space, process, and form is an illusion. We're still perfectly free. Okay? There's no fixation or boundness of any appearance whatsoever. And to show us that God is not in any con we're not in any contest with God. God remains unchanged. Jesus says, even I can come here. I can choose to the death of the body, crucifixion, if I want to, and I'm free to do so, just as all of you are free to do so. Okay, but you're also free to not choose that. Or even if you choose it, you're so free that you can choose to resurrect the body. Even that's how free you are. In other words, death itself is not a process; it's an appearance. It's a mere non-fixated, unbound appearance. As is everything. It's no different. Death is no different than any other appearance, actually. And he proved it to us. Proved it to us. So we've been struggling with that one for 2,000 years, for sure. But it's a good time to get it right. Capernaum, Capernaum, Capernaum. Capernaum is really where Jesus hung out after he left Nazareth. Once he was, baptized by John the Baptist in the Jordan River, and then he started calling his apostles, and went to the marriage festival in Cana, and did his first turned water into wine, and then he, headed over to Capernaum, where he began teaching in the synagogue there. It's on the northwestern coast of the Sea of Galilee. And Capernaum was his headquarters, really. That's where he spent, he'd go on trips, journeys in Galilee and the land of the Gentiles and Tyre and Sidon to the north and Caesarea Philippi, to also the northeast. And he'd come back and from those trips and he'd hang out in Capernaum. Right on the sea, right on the northwestern Sea of Galilee, right on the shore there, actually. And this is where a lot of the apostles lived. I believe John, Peter, and Andrew and a number of the apostles lived in Capernaum. They're from Capernaum. In fact, there's a church right now over the house of Peter, who they live right on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. They were fishermen. They were fishermen. They'd get up in the morning, walk from their little stone huts to the shore where their boats were, get in the boats and go out on the Sea of Galilee and go fishing. So that this is and so Jesus hung out with them there in a little fishing village. And then when at Passover, when you had to go to Jerusalem, it was an obligation. He traveled down the valley, the River Jordan River Valley, down to 60 miles or so down to Jerusalem. Go to the temple there, and I guess you paid a temple tax, or you did something. You needed to do something there. That's so, and then he would go back eventually back to the Sea of Galilee, to Capernaum, and that's it's a pretty simple situation actually, 60 miles. So you can condense it down, and you can recognize it, and you can kind of simplify it and streamline it all. He had his Galilean ministries where he'd just kind of go around the various areas of Galilee, Cana, Nazareth, and those areas, Nazareth, where he was originally from. They didn't like him there, though. They didn't say go back to Capernaum. It's not, that complicated, actually. The ministry is not that complicated. It's all of it's not that complicated. But they're trying to make it seem very complicated. Really, they really are. But I've been able to reduce it down and clear out the cobwebs and just say, oh, okay, there's a little complication that people get confused, because when he was arrested and then brought to Pilate, Pontius Pilate was like the governor. He was like, what's it called, the precept or something like that. Basically, he was the head of Roman law and orders, and he was in charge of law and order in the province of Judea. And then he sent him to Herod Antipas, who actually was not the Herod from Judea, which hadn't been a Herod in here's a confusion that people have, that confuses them about history, is that the geographical area around Jerusalem was traditionally called Judea, okay? And Herod the Great ruled over that area as sort of a client king, as it were, of Rome. They were a vassal state of Rome, but they had their sort of autonomy. They could call themselves Herod Great was a king of that area. And then when Herod's successor, Herod Archelaus, was so terrible, they banished them to Germany or something, the year AD 6 or 7. Then Rome turned the whole area of Idumea, which is south of Judea, Idumea, Judea, and Samaria, which is just north of Judea. They turned all those into one province called Judea. Called Judea. So there was those three areas that were now lumped into one called Judea. So Pontius Pilate was this precept of Roman law, in charge of Roman law and order in the province of Judea. Province of Judea. And above the province of Judea was the province of Syria, which concluded Galilee, the Galilee area. And Herod Antipas was this governor, Roman governor, of the Galilee area. And maybe Decapolis, which is on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, and Perea, which is also on the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee. But he was the governor of that area, the area where Jesus was born, and a lot of his ministry was in the Galilean area, okay, up by the Sea of Galilee. So Pontius Pilate sent him to the governor of Galilee to try to get him to judge Jesus, because he said all the crimes happened in Galilee. Most of the crimes happened in Galilee, so you're supposed to judge him. But this governor, what was part of the tetrarchy that took over from Herod the Great when Herod the Great died, and they were a client state, so to speak. They were a client state, that area. They didn't have authority to put anyone to death. They did not. They did not represent Roman law. Okay, they did not represent Roman law. It was Pontius Pilate who had the authority to try Jesus in Jerusalem, in the province of Judea, and sentence him to death. Herod Antipas could not do that. Could not do that. So this is something that people don't quite understand. Who was this Herod that he said? Herod Antipas was this sort of, they didn't call him a king, they called him some other term. He wasn't quite a king, tetrarch or something. And he's the one that had John the Baptist executed, beheaded, because of a marriage that he, illegitimate marriage that he carried out. And that John the Baptist criticized him severely over. And so he's the one that happened to be visiting in Jerusalem at the time. He happened to be visiting there. That's why he wasn't living there permanently. He was visiting. He was visiting. All right. He was just visiting there. And Pilate said, "Hey, I can wash my hands of this. I don't want to get in trouble. Maybe I can get Herod Antipas to." Pass judgment on it. But Herod Antipas said, no, I don't have any authority to, I don't see anything, I don't condemn this man, no, send him back to Pilate, says, you deal with him, I got no authority on this. And now, originally, the Sanhedrin, which was one of the five groupings that of sort of Jewish law that the Romans allowed in that area, and this is called the Sanhedrin, then they brought charges of sedition and towards the Jews, but that they couldn't, Pontius Pilate could not condemn Jesus to death on that, so they charged him with sedition and treason against Rome, so that Pontius Pilate could then make a judgment on that. He was the chief legal authority in the province of Judea. Pontius Pilate was. He had the authority to put you to death, which ultimately did. To put Jesus to death. So a little history lesson, straightening things out. So we don't get confused. It's confused when all this stuff is being thrown at us, which is being thrown at us right now. If you're just clear about a few little things, you're not going to be bothered by it, because you've already clarified some of the confusion. I mean, Herod the Great died in 4 BC. Okay, so Jesus was said to be born in the reign of Herod the Great and had to flee Herod the Great. And only when hearing that Herod the Great had died, they came back from Egypt, but they heard that, now it's Herod Archelaus there, and they said, uh-oh, we can't settle in Judea, which was, when they came back, there was still this client state of Judea around Jerusalem. So they went north of Jerusalem, okay, north of Jerusalem back to Galilee, and to Nazareth. Which is in Galilee, and that's where Herod Antipas was ruling. And Herod Antipas had a different feelings. You know, he wasn't so much into trying to get rid of Jesus, so to speak. They feared the Herod Archelaus down in Judea much more. So they settled in Galilee and Nazareth, and that's where Jesus supposedly was, you know, brought up as a builder. A worker with wood, whether he was building structures or building, making plow handles and axe handles and various, you know, wooden implements. You know, it's not clear, but he was like a contractor. He was a builder, so to speak, worked with wood. Very, you know, craftsman with wood. Carpenter, they call him a carpenter. And we don't know exactly what Jesus did between, you know, his youth in Nazareth and showing up at the Jordan River when he was about 30-something. Could have been 30, 32, 29. Nobody's exactly sure. If he was born in like 4 BC and then he showed up in AD 29, then he could have been as much as 35 at that point in time, actually. They said he's basically 30-something, 30-ish or something. Well, it's not exactly clear how old Jesus was, and there's a lot of different arguments about it. But that's not really that important. He showed up there, but we don't know exactly between his youth and then showing up in his 30-something years, you know, where was he? What did he do? And some people say he went to India and studied at Buddhist monasteries in India, actually, or Hindu, you know, he went, had Hindu guru or went to Buddhist teachings or something. Some people say that he was a Buddhist monk. Others say he traveled down to Egypt and developed some, I don't know, whatever, in Egypt, spiritual teachings or something in Egypt. Well, we don't know. Those were the last years of Jesus. Maybe he was just a carpenter. Maybe he was just a carpenter. But see, not knowing what he did day to day as a carpenter, not, how does that change his teachings at all? It doesn't interfere or detract from his teachings in the slightest bit. Pure non-dualism. And this is what the Holy Spirit turns our attention towards, saying, it's time to, you know, focus where our focus has to be. Now, eventually it may all come out in the wash, and maybe there'll be clarifications just to put the record straight or I don't know whether it has any importance or not. I guarantee you, if Jesus were to set the record straight and say exactly what happened, I doubt that any Christians would change their mind at all, or anybody in the world would really change their mind one way or the other about it. They're so locked into, you know, the logic of arrogant deviation really binds the mind. It really does. It binds the mind. So you just can't turn your attention somewhere else. I've noticed throughout my life that it's amazing the play of attention and what goes on and how the logic of arrogant deviation plays with our attention, as does the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit frees our attention from the logic of arrogant deviation. And for instance, the Holy Spirit will show me something and say, look right here, and I'll look and I'll say, wow, I would have completely missed that if I hadn't got this feeling of turn my attention, shift my attention, just a feeling like I want to shift my attention here. And then I see something, I would have completely missed that. And it's very interesting what I see. And what I've done is I pointed out to others, say, look at this. And they'll say, huh? And then whatever I saw is gone. You know, usually it doesn't, it's quick. Things happen quick in this world, actually. And as soon as it's gone, they'll suddenly look and say, where, what? I don't see it. Now, I have experienced this with people thousands and thousands of times. It is impossible for this to be a coincidence. And I know exactly how it happens now. Is the logic of arrogant deviation, the logic that arrogance brings to us, is saying, don't look until whatever is there isn't there anymore, and then look, and then you can say, hey, there's nothing there to see. Someone, you're trying to fool me. See, Holy Spirit's trying to fool me, trying to trick me. It's not nothing there. And then you can feel self-righteous about your arrogance. There's no question in my mind that this takes place. I've tested it out over and over and over and over again. Now the point where I don't even bother trying to say, hey, look, I know they won't look. I'll say, look over there, and they'll look at me instead, like, huh, what, huh, where, what are you saying? Oh, look over there, oh, it's gone, I don't see anything. What are you talking about? Well, you're trying to fool me, you're crazy, that kind of stuff. This is how that is. So the play of our attention is very important. And when you allow the Holy Spirit to suggest to your attention where it might benefit, where it might find benefit, then you will find, you begin to look where others don't look. You begin to see what others don't see, because they're intentionally not looking, they're intentionally not seeing. Their arrogance wants to remain blind to the truth. This is the whole purpose of arrogance, is to say that there's a problem with reality, to say that there's a contest with God, to say that God suspended reality because we insisted upon it. We told God there has to be a contest to determine the truth. Truth is something that's yet to be determined, so you must suspend reality and be subject to the outcome of this contest that we are imagining is taking place. There's no such contest. There's been no suspension of reality. None of that is true. But we keep looking to avoid seeing that it's not true. We play with our attention in such a clever way that we say, well, there's no proof that it's true. I don't see any proof. It's like people asking about proof of UFOs or extraterrestrials. You know, they say, there's no proof. I don't see any proof, you know. Because they wherever there's proof, they turn away. They won't look at it. They refuse to look at it. I mean, there's so much proof. It's ludicrous to say that there's no such thing as extraterrestrials. And yet, you know, so many people will say there's not a one shred of evidence that indicates anything like that. It's all swamp gas, you know. This is how it works. That's arrogance, is they refuse to see. They absolutely refuse to see. So seeing is difficult because you have to keep taking risks. You have to trust in the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to look here. I'm going to check this out. And as you do, you gradually begin to lose your fear of seeing and trusting the Holy Spirit more. Now, I still have to, you know, keep doing it. But you become much less blind, and much freer to feel you can relate relate as truth consciousness, and you can accept those precepts into your mind. You can allow the truth to you realize the truth is abiding with me. You can wake up to this and say, the truth is with me. I am the truth. I abide in truth. The truth is one. There's no escaping from it, actually. So our arrogance makes believe that reality is something yet to be determined. So you might call our perception that we have a normal perception, it's a yet-to-be-determined perception. We're not seeing anything as it is. Tibetans have a word for seeing everything as it is called Rigpa. And this means you're seeing everything as it is, not suspending seeing as it is, as if there's a contest, and what it is yet to be determined. You see, this is what we see. We're blind to how things really appear, because we're insisting that however they're appearing, it's been suspended, and we're in this yet to be determined condition, and we won't know what it really is until later, in the future. So everything seems somehow unalive to us. You know, they say the Rigpa, with vision of how things are, everything seems absolutely intensely alive and clear. Sometimes we get glimpses of this in our dreams or half-sleep state, and it's quite something. Our mind is quite something. I experienced it last night after the Bible study I was doing. I went to sleep, or tried to, and I was so, the wow was so strong, I couldn't sleep all night, and my mind started just imagining all these ruins and ancient buildings and amazing landscapes, etc., of stone of all types, and I was just watching. I was like, just absolutely amazing. And I only felt like I feel like I'm not sharing it with anyone. Like I'm all alone, isolated. I don't like this. This is so beautiful. I want this to realize that everyone is seeing this too. I mean, sharing it with everyone. Just the instant creativity of the mind, whatever I wanted to shift my mind towards, somehow just the slightest desire, and there was just this complete, like a incredible city. You were just made out of millions and millions of stones, and it just all appeared instantly, you know, and I just like gliding through all these landscapes, and they'd all just if I wanted, whatever I wanted to appear, it would appear in just, you know, incredible detail and beauty and complexity, and I said, how am I doing this? The mind's just doing this effortlessly. There's no effort involved at all. So the creativity of the mind is beyond comprehension, actually. It really is. After a while, I just said, wow, this is, I feel terrible because I want to be able to share this, with others. I just, it doesn't feel right. So I don't know. But so, but in seeing things as they are, we're not seeing anything as it is right now. We're not perceiving anything as it is. We're seeing it as if it were suspended. Like it's not, it's yet to be determined. At least this is how I am looking at it this way. I feel it's a nice way to look at it. I know Jesus says you see only the past, and I've never quite got that. I have to admit, I've never, the past, I don't understand the past. What is the past? I don't quite understand, but he says you're just seeing just reactions to what you saw. But why will we be seeing reactions? I believe it's because we believe that reality's been suspended, and it's nothing is real yet. That's why we believe in time to allow this contest to play out until we determine, what is ultimately real and what isn't. But the truth is that everything is real right now, in the now. There isn't anything anywhere else that can be true because the now is an expression of our creativity, and our creativity is instantly reflected to us exactly as we want it to be. So there's no deviation from what we desire to see at all or experience at all, none. So how could we say anything is yet to be determined? At any moment, there's no such thing as yet to be determined. It's impossible. And yet somehow we're seeing like images, Jesus says, just images. We're not seeing the livingness of the experiencing, the vibrancy, the aliveness that reflects our desires of experiencing in pure spaces. We're not seeing it. We're seeing like an image of it, which feels like as if reality has been suspended, right? When you're viewing reality as just an image, as images, you feel as if reality has been suspended. It's not real. It's an image, and then we believe that the true nature of reality is something that is yet to be determined based on who wins this contest and how the so-called autonomy of this dream or dreaming somehow makes this how it goes, as if there's some path of destiny taking place. There isn't any path of destiny taking place. There's not at all. Everything is simply arising in the now, exactly as we ask it to arise, as our mind asks it to arise. And that's all that's taking place. There's no such thing as destiny or fate or working out and the evolution. There's none of that's true. No, that's not happening at all. But we are imagining a contest. So it seems as though we are going towards winning this contest to make images autonomous, make this dream autonomous from the dreamer, as it were, to prove that reality isn't real and that there's this new reality. So we make it seem as though there's evolution taking place, like there's progress taking place, like there's some destiny that we're going, We dream a dream of that. To make it seem we're winning the contest. But the truth is, there is no contest, and we're actually going nowhere. We're just wandering around aimlessly, as Jesus puts it. Wandering around aimlessly is all that we have done. So Jesus was involved with a lot of healings and supernatural, they call it miracles, etc. And he's just showing it that there's no such thing as victim consciousness. Nothing is bound. Nothing is bound. Nothing is happening. Now, I don't know exactly how that relates to nature, as far as relating to us. We're absolutely free. Now, as far as walking on the water, well, we're free to walk on the water. We can have that appearance happen. Absolutely. Now, as far as, for instance, turning the water into wine, well, water's just an appearance, okay? We can change the appearance instantly into appearance of wine, okay? So all appearances, including this, our bodies, can be instantly changed into anything at all, actually. This is the sovereignty of the mind. Okay, the mind is sovereign. And Jesus is showing the mind is sovereign, not the body, but the mind. So the mind could have appearance of Jesus' body being crucified, and then the mind could have the appearance of Jesus' body being resurrected. Just as simple as turning the water into wine, which was at the Feast of Cana, where the I guess there's something to do with cleanliness, that the guests had washed their hands. They had like big jars of 20-gallon jars, and washing all their hands. They wash before they go in, and all the jars were like kind of almost empty. And Jesus said to the servants, go fill all the jars up. And then he came back and said, okay, dip your ladle in and go serve the guests, because I guess they had been drinking wine a lot, and they found out that now the water was actually wine. Well, it's just an appearance. Wine's just an appearance, like anything else is an appearance. So the mind can simply decide, oh, I want to see wine. Okay, there's the wine. It's just an appearance. It's just light. Everything's just light, living light. It's just all appearance. It's just all the play of appearance. So there may be some who can relate to Jesus without even referencing Christianity at all, actually. They may be very, very aware of like quantum physics and light and how all this, you know, holographic stuff. And they may be able to understand really clearly and relate with Jesus. Probably much better than I can. There's some people like that in the world that from a sort of a scientific standpoint, abstract science, quantum physics standpoint, they somehow, you know, understand all this holograms and it just, they have some sort of really, really clear understanding about this, which is great. And Jesus said, greater things than these shall you do. Well, of course, we can do anything at all, actually. We can manifest the universe this instant, our mind can. Just like I was, my mind, the mind is not my mind, it is the mind. There's just one mind. It's all creative. And we have access to it. We are it. And so the mind, I asked, the mind was desiring. I asked the mind, spirit asked the mind. I want to see, you know, all these depictions of incredible, amazing ruins and buildings and landscapes and everything, and it was just presented to me effortlessly, beyond anything I could have imagined. I just was like, just watching this like movie. Just, because it's really quite something. So there's just one mind. Just one mind. We don't have individual minds, so to speak. That all power of the mind is given to all. See? It's like that. And someday it will click. Someday it will click. And this is, you know, we will then be in truth consciousness instead of victim consciousness, which is what we are burdened with now. So really the world is, again, there's this takeover of this planet by cosmic corporate culture, which is a consortium of extraterrestrials in alliance with some groups on this planet who believe in victim culture, victim consciousness. And to protect us from victimization, they have this hierarchy, you know, strong rulership, which, you know, tries to regulate and police everything, make sure that nothing happens to anyone, they, you know, fix all the problems, and we give all our power over to these leaders and these bureaucracies, and that's what they want. They want us to believe in victim consciousness, which really turns you into a slave, de facto slave. And Jesus says, I don't want, in his farewell discourse in John, he says, I don't want to see you as slaves. I don't want you to see yourself as slaves at all. See yourself as my friends. I want to see you as friends. Okay? Friends, not slaves. Friends, not slaves. So he's talking about the difference between truth consciousness and victim consciousness. Victim consciousness, you feel as though you're a slave. Truth consciousness, you feel you're a friend of all. As Jesus feels that he's a friend of all of us. All of us. Without exception. So the takeover of this planet is really a takeover of victim consciousness is taking over the planet. And so the last thing they wanted Jesus to show up and start spreading truth consciousness here. So they're trying to confuse everyone's mind as much as possible before that happens, because you can tell that they are very nervous about Jesus coming back right now. You should be able to read the tea leaves and realize that those who don't desire for him to come back at all, that's the last thing they would want. They're the ones pushing all this stuff out there, really trying to confuse everybody, because they are so jittery about it. They just hope to confuse the issue so badly that people would just kind of be dull and apathetic in their minds, just say, oh, I can't really figure it out. I'm just going to have to sit on the sideline here and just, I don't know, I've got suspicions and mistrust and uncertainty. And, they're trying to bring your mind into this mistrustful condition. Right? This is what they're doing. So you know they must be very jittery and nervous about Jesus coming back. With good reason, because he's already back, actually. So they're really trying to confuse everything as much as possible. These are the times we live in, great times. So it boils down to, great simplicity. We had this idea we wanted to be greater than God, which is arrogance. And we've been wanting to see how this idea plays out. Well, we've found out how it plays out. We try to camouflage our arrogance and defend it. And in doing so, we end up thinking that there's this contest with God, and reality is yet to be determined, and all this stuff. We don't see the now. We don't see reality as it is at all now. And we engage in a very, very severe, crazy farce, really. Very farcical undertakings. You look at history, and back then it was just like thousands of years ago, constant warfare. I mean, it's just, things settle down for a couple of years, and then there's another massive war, and then they settle down for a few more years, another war. And it's just endless invasion and fighting. It's ridiculous. So it's just insane, absolutely. So we know how it plays out. And then we say, you know what? I think I've had about enough of this. This whimsical idea of arrogance and believing I can dictate to God, what God is, that God has to be in a contest, has to suspend reality in order to engage in a contest, and it's possible for God to lose this contest, and we can change reality and all this. This is not total nonsense, total arrogance. And we say, well, we're tired of this, we need this, let's just set it down and repent, let's set it down. Except that there is no contest, there is no winning or losing, there's only the perfect freedom. For all. One mind, one mind, one empowerment. All has all. One empowerment. No other empowerment. Just one empowerment from the very beginning. From the very beginning, one empowerment. Now, the Holy Spirit, what is the Holy Spirit? Well, the Holy Spirit's a reminder of that fact for us. It's a reminder. It's like a blessing. It's a blessing of reminder and reassurance and reminding us and being able to help our attention so we can be reminded. Can't be reminded, free our attention up from all the distractions that our arrogance throws up for the. It's amazing how many distractions and how clever we are. We put our creativity into distracting ourselves and camouflaging our arrogance. So we're very, very clever about it, to say the least. That's why if you listen to the Holy Spirit and your attention, you'll be seeing, you'll see things, you'll see what others don't see, recognize really. And you feel like kind of alone, because you realize the way you're viewing everything and the context you see is nobody else is really seeing that context, hardly any. You go to a shopping mall or something, and just what the Holy Spirit will show you is quite different. It really is like everyone's sleepwalking. It looks like they're sleepwalking, actually. Because the Holy Spirit just say, notice that. Ah, context. I see what's going on here. Okay, that's it, I see, that's plenty. Now I see it. Okay. And then later on, you understand the context, and you feel, okay, I saw what's important to see, and I recognize the direction that's being pushed in. Now, I think I'll stay away from the mall. Definitely stay away from the mall. Now, goddess is very tricky, which is a severe defense we have, where what the goddess told me was that she was preparing me for Jesus, that Jesus was coming back, but she said, I will help you prepare because I know what he's like. I've been with him for so long that I know exactly what he's like. And so if you get used to me, you will be able to relate to Jesus. This is what I was told. See, I said, wow, yeah, I knew Jesus was returning, so I said, this will help me get ready. But what I found out was that what she really wanted to do was enslave me, had no intention whatsoever of getting me ready for Jesus to come back, and the goddess has no idea what Jesus is like, hasn't spent any time with him whatsoever. But it was a very good ruse, you know, trick to use to say that. She said, yeah, I'm Jesus' partner. I'm helping everyone get ready for his return so you'll be able to relate with him. And it turned out it was just the opposite. It was a trick. And she wanted us to get used to her, the goddess, and serve her as slaves to try to beautify this world and make this world our true home, and believe that bodies are, you know, our home, and this material world's our home, and all of that stuff. Did not know anything about true non-dual truth at all. So it's a very tricky defense, and it certainly fooled me for a while, to a certain extent. So that there is that defense that we use, this is just a trick we play on ourselves. But this does show that I was aware that Jesus was returning, and I knew I had to get ready to relate with Jesus. And so I was absolutely, you know, full on willing to do whatever it took to get the necessary familiarity. So I was also then vulnerable to this sort of trick, vulnerable to it, because I was so willing. I said, yeah, if this helps, I'll do it. That's great. Now, ultimately, the Holy Spirit, you know, when you get lemons, you make lemonade. So the Holy Spirit enabled me to make lemonade out of it all. And I was able to examine my valuing of the world and then, you know, severely reject the goddess and all of that defense and see through it. And so that ended up benefiting me, but I still had to really get back to, you know, the true non-dual teachings and really focus in on that, which I have been doing during all these tapings. So, you know, you could have been misled. Our defenses mislead us. Absolutely. Our arrogance has these very clever defenses. But it does point out that we're aware at some level that Jesus is coming back. And during this time, the feeling was like it's going to be very soon, very soon. We've all had this feeling, you know, something great is going to happen. It's going to happen very, very, very soon. Well, I say it's already happened. It's already happened pretty much right at the end of April, beginning of May. It could have been April 30th, May 1st, something like that. I can even check the video where I made the video. He's back. He's back. He's back. It's already happened. So from this point, we just, you know, keep working on our relating skills, and take it from here, and get used to stop worrying about when's Jesus coming back. He's already back, so we can drop all the worry about when and all that kind of stuff. And now it's great, and it helps us shift our minds, shift our attention. Our attention is now has a slightly different focus. And keep in mind this feral discourse in John. He said, I my last words to you is, I now see you as friends, and you can see me as a friend. This is very important. This is very key. Because, of course, they were wanting to view him as the Messiah, as this great divine king to rule over all of them. And he said, that's not it. This is a New Testament. This is a New Testament. And I am now your friend. I am now your friend, you see. Very important words of Jesus. And he has not deviated from that one bit in the thousands of years since. Because in A Course in Miracles, he stresses that. He stresses equality. He says, I don't come to lead you and walk in front of you. I come to walk beside you as a friend. To walk beside you as a friend. And so we have to up our game, you know, so we're big time too. So we can walk beside Jesus as a friend. You have to up your game. You have to up your clarity. You have to really, you know, repent in order to do that. That's the challenge to the path of repentance, as the challenge. It has been the challenge all along, actually. So the Jews weren't very happy with Jesus, to say the least. They said, wait a minute. You were supposed to be, you know, our king, great warrior king, and keep all our rules and regulations and do exactly what we tell you to do, and you have to observe and agree with, you know, everything that we teach. And Jesus didn't go along with that. So they really, really got upset about that. Says, we can't have that. We can't have that. We don't want repentance. You know, we want to find some way to glorify our arrogance, actually. To be king, you know, all the rulers of the whole world, arrogant rulers of a whole arrogant world. To be the greatest of the arrogant. That kind of thing. Jesus said, no, we're all equal. We're all, love one another, love one another. That's also John. He said, command, his final command, love one another, love one another. I'm your friend. My command, final command to you, the ultimate commandment, love one another. Okay. And how do you love another? By recognizing their perfect freedom. By dropping your arrogance, your own arrogance, and realizing everyone's equally free, equally empowered. All have perfect empowerment of perfect freedom. Drop your arrogance. Love one another and support one another on the path of repentance. And realize that nobody can be dispossessed of their perfect freedom and empowerment. Nobody can be dispossessed of it in any way, shape, or form. Even death doesn't do it, because, again, death is not a process, it's a choice. That's right. Everything we're experiencing is just a choice of appearance. Of appearance experiencing, as it were. Appearance experiencing. Everything is just a choice. So, no one's bound. Nothing happens to the mind in death. We're not bound by it. It's just this just shift of appearance. Water to wine. Whatever, just a shift of appearance. How we doing? Pretty good. Pretty good. It's a little chilly out here. I didn't sleep at all last night. I couldn't sleep. My mind was just too on fire. Really, as I did this Bible study, and there are ways to do it, the internet actually can help with that, if you know how to use it. And I realized that we've been bogged down. That Christianity hasn't presented itself clearly enough. Very few really have it streamlined and clear in their minds. We've been obsessed, like, so much with the Old Testament too. You know, it's not, forget it. Get the New Testament clear in your mind, and it has not been clear. I see that now. I said, wow. Now that it's so much more clear to me, I just said, what are we even doing here? We've been bogged down with what? Arrogance. Our arrogance makes us wander around aimlessly, where we just can't quite put it together. We just can't put it together, and it's just that's the feeling. You know, Christians can quote scripture, you know, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. You know, but do they really see the context of Jesus' life? Do they really see it? Just as it is, very simple, actually. Just as it is, very simple. Brought the message of repentance to us. Equality, pure love of God, brought the truth to us. Showed us that victim consciousness isn't true. That's what he was doing. People get obsessed about numerology. I mean, everybody's, not everyone, there's so much obsession about Bible codes and numerology and trying to determine exactly when Jesus returns and all this kind of stuff. I say, hey, drop it. Forget it. He's already here. I didn't figure anything out numerically or anything. I became aware that Jesus coming into the world saying, I'm here. I'm back. And who wants to relate with me? I was spiritually aware of this taking place. because my attention was willing to look at it. So that's how you do it. You know, these people keep crunching the numbers. They'll do it forever. They keep crunching numbers, and everybody has a different take on when, you know, Jesus is returning. A lot of Protestants, some Protestantism has gotten dragged down to that, where everybody's their own expert. And the key to it is to keep working on right spiritual practice, so your attention is willing to see when Jesus does arrive. So when Jesus arrives here, we'll notice it. Say, oh, I see. This is what's happened. And that's exactly what I did. That's all I did. I didn't figure anything out exactly when he's coming back. No, I knew it was going to be soon, real soon, and it getting closer and closer and closer. I said, any day is possible. I remember I said in the videos, like, Jesus will come back any day, right now, any day. I don't know when, but it feels that close. So I was certainly working, knowing that it's very close, man. And so I was right. He's here as a friend again, as a friend. As a friend. Now, this whole Mary Magdalene thing is such a joke. It's such a diversion. It's ridiculous. When Mary Magdalene saw Jesus at the resurrection, she cried out, "Rabbi, Rabbi!" You know, she her relationship to Jesus was saw him as Rabbi. Okay, that's it. Jesus was not married to Mary Magdalene, and didn't see her as any different than anyone else. Jesus sees nobody as special. Jesus is equally friends with everybody. I know they say that John was the one that Jesus, quote-unquote, loved, but what it was that John was somehow able to relate to Jesus on the level of a friend better than others. It's not that Jesus loved him more than anyone else, actually. It's just that's how they interpret it. So, Jesus is adamant that special relationships are a great defense against truth. Adamant about that. So there was no special relationship between Jesus and Mary Magdalene that whatsoever. That is ludicrous. A big lie, actually. You know, in none of the interactions was it suggested that they were married husband and wife. She didn't say husband or something. She said Rabbi. Rabbi, you're back. Rabbi, wow. Okay. Now, maybe she was someone who had repented. That's what they say, which is fine. There were many who repented. There were many who repented. So people are trying to twist everything as much as possible. You know, just trying to twist things to support victim consciousness, special relationship, victim consciousness, truth, yet to be determinedness. All right. Supporting this takeover of this planet, this hostile takeover of this planet, trying to get rid of truth consciousness here, trying to drag a red herring across our path and have us chase after that. You know, as I say, no, Jesus is back. He's already back. Don't let anybody drag a red herring across your path. Jesus is back already, so we don't have to worry about it. Say, well, when's he coming back? When's he coming back? We can say, hey, he's already here. So let's keep working on relating, so at some point we'll be able to relate with Jesus. I mean, Jesus showed himself to 500 people in Galilee area. After the resurrection, 500 people, there's, you know, multitudes saw him. Multitudes saw him. We don't know much about that. And he went about for some time just working wonders and having a tremendous time and relating with many. So what's to say he can't relate with many here? Coming as now that he's back, that he won't relate with many. Doesn't have any problem with that. Now, might not do, you know, physical miracles of bread and loaves and walking on the water stuff, because he's more, it was important as friendship and relating and being able to relate in the spirit of truth consciousness instead of victim consciousness and start to get used to relating with one another in truth consciousness. Now, some people, their faith may make them whole. Sure. That's fine. Nothing to stop them from that. No need to try to stop anybody. If they want to, the dead want to get up, they can get up. If the sick want to, you know, get out of bed, they can get out of bed. If that's what they want to do, that's fine. But nobody has to make a big deal about that. It's just their faith made them whole, meaning their faith, for a moment, they realize, hey, I can appear any way I want to appear. My experiencing can be anything I want it to be. I'm not bound by time, space, process, or form at all. I don't have to wait for something to be determined. There's nothing to be determined. There's absolutely nothing to be determined. Oh. Because all experiencing is right now. All experiencing is always right now. So there's nothing to be determined about our experiencing whatsoever. It's all right now. So, talking about Jesus right now, that's the topic of the times right now, actually. Now, in the Catholic Mass last week, the priest, it was Mother's Day, and the priest was wearing a vestment with the Virgin of Guadalupe on the front, which I found a little bit odd because it's actually a painting that the Spanish had commissioned, and was not really a miraculous appearance at all. She's actually fertility goddess. It was designed to convert people to Catholicism and help replenish the population, because most of the people had died from illness, from Europeans brought in illness, smallpox and stuff like that, and the countryside was just decimated, completely decimated. But this pagan goddess, which actually was a picture of the pagan goddess they'd already been worshipping at the time, they concocted this story about it, that it appeared miraculously, and all this stuff around it, this isn't so, actually. It's not so. I fell for that one too for a while. Became an expert on it all, and then eventually, in studying it even more thoroughly as I should have, my arrogance blinded me. Like studying more thoroughly, I realized that it was a painting that was commissioned, and there was nothing miraculous about it whatsoever. Anyway, he said, you know, it's Mother's Day, and the mothers are the ones that we pattern. We get our love of God from, that the mother love is a reflection of divine love, and we can look at the love we have for our mother and the love the mother has for us. Actually, so the love that a mother has for us is the same as the love that God has for us. You know, I said, wow, really? That's mother worship right there, isn't it? Church is absolutely free falling into mother worship at this time. Free falling into it. The love of a mother for offspring is this, you know, is this facsimile, is giving us the divine love that God gives us, really? Isn't the love for the love that mother has for her children very special? We call it just very special love. It's called special love, where she views her children as special and more dear to her than anyone else, and by far nothing else even comes close. And that you know, her children are way more important than other children to her, and that she has this exclusive special love for them, will do anything for them. God's love is completely non-special, completely non-exclusive, completely all-inclusive, completely impartial. So mother love is like the opposite of God's love. And yet here the teaching was that it's the same. Wow, you talk about teaching the wrong message. And it's right there. And of course everyone's clapping, saying, yeah, that's absolutely, yeah, we understand. No. Mother's love is throughout the whole kingdom of form, where the mother looks out after the offspring. That's something that happens as part of keeping this contest going, a form, time, space, process, and form, the supposed contest of keeping this autonomous dream, the supposed autonomous dream is not autonomous, but keeping it going. So the mother's intensely focused on keeping it going. So her children are very important in that regard. But it has nothing to do with God's love at all, actually. God's love is absolutely impartial, non-preferential. Even to the standpoint where Jesus could come into this world and have himself crucified. And God did absolutely nothing to stop it whatsoever. See, totally impartial. We're all free. God loves all equally. That's true love. Pure love, true love is only God's love is pure love, true love, the true divinity. Only God has the empowerment for us, not mother, not mother. Mother does not know best. Absolutely not. Mother knows specialness. That is arrogance. Okay, it's the quote unquote love of arrogance, the special love of arrogance is what it really is. I've heard of some women who have gotten the pure love of God, and it's really amazing testimony, where they feel that they're going to be incarcerated or something because they don't love their children specially anymore, and the children don't look at them as mother. Here's the one that gives me special love. You can still give them care and love and all that, but it's not special. You feel that everyone has all perfect love, but you don't necessarily have to. You could still function as a mother just fine, actually. But the feeling of specialness, special love, in terms of arrogance, is not there. So some women have done that, actually. There are some women that seem to be on the, you know, close to enlightenment in some ways. It's a little ragged in some ways, but in other ways they seem to be pretty close to it. All over the place, here and there. And it's not easy for them. It's not easy. Because they're taught that this is their identity. You know, you have to have this special love. And they think that they're somehow betraying life itself or something. It's not true. And of course, the children will be greatly benefited by this, by being able to recognize, there's special love is only arrogance and nothing else, and it will help them in their path of repentance too. So it's a great thing. It's a great thing. It's not like you disown your children or anything like that. You still understand the pragmatic aspects of it and still care for them. But as far as teaching specialness to them, no. Now, social services these days will probably take your children away from you, if that's the case. They say you've had some sort of psychotic break. I mean, their social services terrified that anyone might be enlightened and teach enlightenment to their children. So anything that they can claim shows some sort of dysfunction from their measurement, absurd way of measuring, logic of absurd deviance, arrogant deviance, they'll say, got to take the children away, and you'll never see them again. We won't tell you where they are. We'll place them with some family and that kind of thing. So women are very frightened of that right now, actually. Women have been very severely targeted and intimidated. And that's this threat of taking your children away is very severe and very real at this time. You know, it's like the Gestapo right now, social services. You know, if anything the kid says at school gets to the teacher, and the teacher calls social services, says, what, the mother is not saying the child's not special, and they, you know, whatever, and the teacher calls social services, and I don't think there's any trial or anything, right? They just break down your door, and the kid's gone. So that's pretty intimidating, to say the least. That's really something. So, hey, it's great that Jesus is here. Wonderful that Jesus is here. And what will he do? Don't know. Don't know. Don't know. But just go with the flow. Just go with the flow. Can't wait. Can't wait for things to heat up. This should be a great summer. You know, what are we getting, you know, toward the mid of May here? So summer's not that far off. Not at all. So the summer of 2015 should be just absolutely amazing. It's got to be. The progress that we're making here is so fast, I have no idea how to extrapolate it forward. And no idea at all. Not even try. So that's part of full stop on the wild. Don't even try to extrapolate it, because that will just slow you down. If you're going so fast, you can't even, you don't even know, you know, you can't extrapolate it forward. So you just don't even try. Just let the speed just continue, and let it go even faster. As a matter of fact. Well, don't want to catch a cold. It's a bunch of respiratory stuff going around here. A lot of people are sick with. I was already sick in January for over a month with that, so hopefully I don't get any of it again. And just being able to speak this is amazing, because I had so many battles with losing my voice, because this stuff is so ambivalent about it that part of me would say it, and then suddenly I'd say, no, I better not say it anymore. Stop, stop. And my voice would disappear and start coughing or whatever. And so this has been a huge struggle to even be able to say any of this, be able to speak like this is extraordinarily difficult here at this time. Extraordinary. Even though I'm using words that you're very familiar with, just the way of putting these words together is extraordinarily difficult, not from a standpoint of clarity, but from a standpoint of the social pressure not to speak this way. It's extreme social pressure. I remember I was young, and people want to know, what you're going to do? What you're going to do in your life? And we had stuff like, okay, what's your career going to be? If you could look forward in your life, do you know what you're going to be? And people say, yeah, I'm going to be a doctor. I say, oh, wonderful, wonderful. And, you know, the girls would say, well, I'm going to be president. And they'd say, oh, wow, you know, that's great. You know, now they're all saying that. You know, I'm going to be the fifth woman president of the United States, of course. And, you know, so they're all saying these things. I'm going to be this. I'm going to be this and that. And so it got to me. I couldn't say what I was going to be, because I knew what I was going to be. I knew, but there's no way I could say it. You know, so it put me in a very awkward position here, because I would have said, well, I'm going to prepare to be able to relate to Jesus Christ when He returns here. That's my life. That's what I'm going to do. When Jesus gets here, I want to be able to relate with Him as a friend. Now, if I said that, I would have been in the psycho ward. You know, you couldn't say that back then. What I said was, well, I want to be a saint. I want to be like Jesus. I sort of couched it that way. I said, well, I want to be like Jesus. I want to be like Jesus. But really, I was... wanted to say, well, I wanted to be able to relate with Jesus as a friend when He returns. Of course, that means that He'd be returning during my lifetime, which I knew He would be returning during my lifetime. And I knew that, but how do you study? You know, I mean, go to, you know, UC California, UC Berkeley, UC California system, and University of California system. And yeah, I want to major in relating to Jesus as a friend when He returns. Where's that major? You know, how do you get a PhD in that? I got a doctorate in relating to Jesus when He returns as a friend. So I realized there's nothing in school that was teaching me this at all. Nothing. So I just started my own curriculum with the Holy Spirit and did all home study. Well, I still had to go to school, but I, you know, just study, attention, all the time, constantly utilizing attention in an effective, helpful way of just amassing as much as I could that was important and helpful to remove the fear. There's so much fear. You know, and Mary Magdalene grabbed Jesus. He said, "No, no, no, don't grab a hold of me. Don't grab a hold of me. Don't prostrate yourself. Don't grab a hold of me. No, I don't want that." So, you know, relating as a friend, you're not going to be falling all over Jesus or grabbing him or groveling at his feet and trying to you know, touch his feet and like they do in Hinduism. And no, you're going to be standing next to him. Stand next to him as a friend and relate. Stand tall and relate. There's nothing that he, you know, what we'll say that we haven't heard before, basically. I mean, the basics are the basics. And we've been working on the basics, so I just said, well, I'll keep working on the basics for sure. Keep working at it. Truth isn't at the mercy of anything. It's not at the mercy of some vote here. It's not at the mercy of belief. It's not at the mercy of arrogance. It's not at the mercy of anything whatsoever. So it's not complex. So, but everybody knew I was different. You know, they didn't know what to say. They didn't. Nobody knew what to make of me. Still don't. Because they, even if I said now, well, you know, my profession is focusing on learning how to, preparing to relate to Jesus as a friend when he returns, and now, as he has returned, preparing to relate to Jesus as a friend now that he's here, that's my focus. And they, you know, they'd say, well, you're absolutely crazy. There's no question about it. You know, 99.9% of the world would say you're absolutely crazy. So, you know, what's the point? What's the point in even saying it, actually? What's the point in even saying it? Well, ultimately, what you want to relate with is truth consciousness. All right? Truth consciousness. You want to be a saint. You want to be enlightened. That's all. And how do you be enlightened? Drop victim consciousness is how you're enlightened. Truth is already true. All we have to do is drop our attempt to make lies true. That's all. Drop our arrogance. Arrogance is our belief we can make lies true. We cannot. So just drop arrogance, which is, you know, victim consciousness, that belief that stuff happens to us that we don't ask for. In other words, that we're not free, that there's something autonomous that is interfering with truth, interfering with our freedom. There's no such thing. That's arrogant to suggest that there is. And so just drop victim consciousness. And then we will see the truth that is already here. It's always here. Truth that is always present. Truth consciousness. Freedom consciousness. Love consciousness. Peace consciousness. Perfection consciousness. Truth consciousness. So, now, and if the apostles could hang out with Jesus and the thousands that he did hang out with in his ministry, if they could hang out with him, you know, why can't we? You know, they didn't have trouble hanging out with him as friends. He must be very friendly. You know, they didn't have any problem. So, and I mean, and we were way clearer about it than they were at that time, right? I mean, they did all sorts of foolish stuff. They were, you know, fishermen from Capernaum. Fishing, and the next moment they're walking with Jesus, you know, and it's like, you know, who is this guy? I don't know, but we really like him. Very friendly guy. But, you know, we have 2,000 years of focusing and working on this now behind us, so that's quite a bit. So why should we have trouble? Why should we have any trouble? We've had some teachers recently with perfect truth consciousness in the world, and we're able to look at them and see, well, I can relate with them. I can relate to them. I think Jesus will be even easier in a lot of ways, actually. Based on his writings, you know, the teachings he's given out, he has a great sense of humor, wonderful Just seems like a very friendly, approachable spirit. Full of delight, full of good humor, full of delight. Unstuck, you know, not no hang up, not hung up. So, seeing the love and the humor of everything, and just you know, it'd just be like a delightful friend, so to speak. The way I look at it, not trying to intimidate anybody, not trying to pull over a big shot routine on anybody. Very, I would say, very meek, very humble, very modest, very unassuming, very carefree, very relaxed. So, why should it be difficult? Shouldn't be a problem at all. And the one experiences I've had recently, it hasn't been a problem at all. Not at all. You just feel like you're just chatting with an old friend, a really dear friend that you know haven't seen in quite some time. So some will start to get it, some will get it, and you know, many people will be very skeptical, and you know, but being a musician in a previous life, and premiering a lot of music for the in Europe, for the world audiences in Europe, you know, usually when the piece would premiere, people wouldn't like it because they what's this, you know, it's a that's they didn't even applaud hard. Like, that's kind of weird. And only later, like sometimes a year or two, they get used to it, and then they start getting into it, and they say, "Wow, this is great! They really love this. We love it." But oftentimes, premieres bomb. Premieres just, you know, because it's new, they haven't heard it before. We love music we've heard before because we're able to embellish it with our minds. I mean, I was aware of this, that when we listen to music that we're really familiar with, if we're really into it, we actually embellish it with our creativity so it sounds even better because we know exactly how it's supposed to go. And in our mind, we say, you know, if it just went just like this, it would sound even better. So we add subtle overtones and stuff to it. I caught myself doing this. It was an amazing experience, really. I was on headphones listening to George Jones. The song was The Grand Tour, and I was listening to it over and over and over as I lay in bed, and I was listening to it, and I was just totally into it. Every, you know, I could feel it, just like, wow, this is incredibly great. And then later, I remember going back over the song again and listening to it when I wasn't in such an intense focus on it. I say, hey, wait a minute, he didn't sing it quite like that. Wait a minute, this is, and then I've clearly realized in going back and listening to it again that I was greatly embellishing the song. Greatly embellishing it. And this is why some people are able to get tremendous satisfaction out of music, because they're literally embellishing it with their own creativity, what they're hearing. And so I have the capacity to do that. I gotta be careful listening to music. I get really wrapped up into it. But I was used to the song so much so that I was able to embellish it. Whereas if you hear a new song, your mind doesn't know how it goes, and so you're not really able to, you know, embrace it and embellish it in with your creativity. So you kind of like, gee, I don't know about that one, and it's just not that great, and kind of underwhelmed by that. And so I've experienced this so much. You know, you just know that the first you know, the first premieres and the first audience, and maybe the first season that you have a song, have a musical composition out, it may not go over that well. So I'm not really expecting anything, you know, with Jesus, as far as Jesus is concerned, and I don't really have any expectations. You know, I always say, Jesus, if you get in front of the world, everybody will boo you, you know, just like, get out of here, you know, they're not going to listen to you, and, you know, most people, I doubt, we're going to change their mind, not going to change their minds one way or the other, you know. Again, if you haven't repented, you're stuck in the logic of arrogance, which just turns you around in circles, basically. You're just spinning your wheels with that. So you can't really change if you're not on the path of repentance. Only the repentant ones are able to shift and say, wow, let me open my mind to this here and get used to it. And because they're wise, they say, hey, you know, I have to get used to it first. Then let me just suspend judgment until I get used to it. Because once you get used to it, then you can embrace it and embellish it in your mind with your own creativity, and you feel that you're part of it. You see, when you're participating in a song, where you're really embellishing it and into it, you are part of the creative process. Actually, listening is a creative art. Actually, art appreciation is art. Actually, absolutely, it is. Art appreciation is a very high art. Some of the greatest artists are actually art aficionados. Some of the music critics, for instance, they're tremendous aficionados. You know, they're just really quite amazing in what they can hear, and in their appreciation of it. It's just quite something. So, yeah. So repent. If you repent and you understand this is important, you're not going to jump the gun and judge it right off the bat. You're going to get used to it. And you say, the more I get used to it, the more I can appreciate it, because the more I can, you know, have this high appreciation, which is an art, a spiritual art in itself, spiritual appreciation. But the unrepentant ones, they're just going to go in circles. They're going to go throw a bunch of, you know, measurements and statistics and trivia and this and that is just stuff that just dead stuff and doesn't go anywhere. It just doesn't work for them at all. Unfortunately, it just doesn't. So I'd say the next step is to relate with Jesus as a friend. See Jesus as a friend, and for, you know, just accept it at that level, like that. That's a real challenge. Now, are you going to interrogate your friend? No. If you're a friend, you're not going to interrogate them. You're not some reporter interrogating them. This is your friend here. You're hanging out with your friend. You're having a good laugh. You're talking about what you like talking about. So I'm not going to interrogate Jesus if I have the opportunity. I'm not going to. If Jesus wants to say something, fine. But I don't feel like I'm going to be in, you know, an interrogating reporter mode. You know, I need to answer all the questions the Christians and scholars have, theological scholars have about you, Jesus. You must do this, or else I can't be your friend. You have to do this for me first. Just, you know, whatever. It doesn't matter. The goal is this communion of friendship here in the spirit of truth. That's the goal. That's what these scholars should be working on. What's important right now is Jesus is back. That's what's important. You know, not whether he went up Mount Hermon or Mount Tabor, you know, or this or that, you know, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. What matters is he's here now. That's what matters. That's what really matters. So, better get in sync with that. That's the wise thing to do. Get in sync with that. And the great thing about friendship is you know, it's authentic. It's one of the only authentic things in the world, I guess, friendship with Jesus, because you can't buy your way into that. You can't seduce your way into that. You can't demand your way into it. You can't get it out of political correctness. You can't sue your way into it. You can't affirmative action your way into it. You know, you can't victimize victim consciousness, victim status your way into it. You can't do any of that stuff into it. You have to earn it. You have to actually earn it through your own repentance. That's the only way. So it's very fair. Totally fair. That's what I really love about it. It's totally fair. You earn it through your own efforts of towards repentance, along with the help of the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. But your focus and attention is needed. It's a play of attention. So and you can't big time Jesus. You know, you can't say, hey, you got to do what I want to do because I'm important. I have high status. Yeah. I'm a doctor. I'm a politician. I'm entitled. I have entitlement, Jesus. You can't say, no, I have entitlement. Well, yeah, entitled. Who gave you entitlement? Well, I'm claiming I have entitlement because it's just and it's right and it's unfair that I don't have it. And so, no, you can't, you know, it doesn't work that way. It's not friendship. Friendship is among equals, and you feel it naturally. So, you know, repentant minds can be friends with other repentant minds, that is for sure. But arrogance doesn't come in friendship. Comes in contestment. Comes in the mode of contestment. Comes in the mode of not yet to be determined if we're friends or not. It's yet to be determined. It's all yet to be determined. You know, this is not genuine friendship. How are we doing here? Well, so I've said my piece here, and we'll go forward from this. And I wish I could say more, but you know, just one step at a time here. And so, wish everyone well in friendship, and we're just full stop in the wow. We're just getting used to this. It's all very beneficial and all very helpful. Getting more and more friendly towards truth consciousness, and more and more departing from victim consciousness. Really doesn't interest us. Less and less and less and less and less. And again, just for the fun of it, see if you see any Christian crosses or Christian insignias or anything that rosaries on, you know, I saw some lady at work with a one of these bracelets, rosary bracelets on. I said, that's cool. I haven't seen anyone like that. It's amazing. Actually was working with that. And I said, that's nice. So see if you see anyone in popular culture that this culture is presenting to us as role models, okay? So keep it very clear that all these shows, everything they're doing is giving us patterns of behavior, expectations, role models, scripts. Okay, see if you see anybody with a Christian cross, Christian ornamentations and symbols of any type. Any Christian talk on mainstream media, any Christian talk whatsoever. Even in all this, you know, the lot of conservative stuff, there's very little Christian talk, actually. It's still political. We're gonna, you know, gotta defeat those guys. They're terrible. Well, how about talking about Jesus, you know? How about talking about, hey, let's turn our attention to, instead of this election that's coming up, which is, it's already there, trying to obsess us, the country, about it. How far off is it? It's a long ways off, isn't it? Long ways off. The election's almost a year and a half away. June, July, August, September, October. Yeah, about a year and a half away. So they're already geeking out on this and going to try to subject us to just nonstop blanket coverage for the next year and a half when we should be focusing on Jesus, actually, that Jesus is here. But rarely do you hear anything like that in conservative talk about Jesus, actually. You know, it's all antagonistic contestment consciousness going on. They should say, hey, you know, Who cares who's elected? It's Jesus is back. Wow, I'm going to put my attention on that. I should be putting my attention on dropping victim consciousness. Now, if you want to also talk of some politics, well, you're free to do that, but make sure you put it in the right, full context, and don't obsess about it. That is for sure. What they're really saying is, hey, the world's turning to victim consciousness and we don't like it. We're right. But what's the remedy? Relating to Jesus, relating with Jesus is the remedy. Relating with truth consciousness is the remedy, actually. Relating with truth consciousness. Jesus is our brother in spirit and truth consciousness. So relating with him would be relating with truth consciousness. And so it's a great example. Put your attention on that. Put your attention on that. Drop all the politics. This stuff is just boring as all heck. Just so boring. It's just so pathetic. It is so pathetic. It is so farcical. Just it's enough. Jesus is back. Let's put our attention where it's supposed to be. That's plain and simple. Plain and simple. Okay. Very great. Did I get? I actually got to 2 hours. Should I continue? Continuing? No, I don't want to, unless there's some reason to. Oh well, look for those crosses, okay? Just catch yourself. Say, wait a minute. Do I see anyone wearing a cross, Christian cross? I know in England they tried to ban crosses in the workplace. Absolutely, and they lost in the European court. But they fought as hard as they could to ban all religious symbols in the workplace, especially Christian crosses, actually, in the workplace. No symbols of Christianity in the workplace. They're trying to ban them in schools, here and everywhere they can. And so they've already been banned in popular media, it seems like. How's this happen? I guess that nothing gets on the television if there's any symbol of Christianity on it somehow. How is that possible? How is that possible? Ask yourself. I mean, when I started seeing this, I was shocked and dismayed. Stunned me. Because the implications of this are so intense, right? So intense. How could something like that right under our noses be taking place? And I Googled it. There's not a single comment on this on the internet as far as I can tell. Nobody is even aware of this. This is extraordinary propaganda. This is propaganda in the most severe way, the most extremely devious, because it's basically saying to you, the norm is that nobody pays any attention to Christianity. And of course, the internet companies have been doing this from the get-go. They give you all these categories. Not a single one has to do with religion or Christianity or anything like that. You can choose. It doesn't exist as far as they're concerned. And so you just get used to that. It just, you. When's the last time you saw somebody? I saw someone in the store last night with this shirt, a Jesus shirt on. Yeah, it was great to see that. Oftentimes, there are these troubled teenagers that are looking for some guidance, and hoping that Jesus will be the dad that they probably don't have. A lot of these kids come from broken homes, actually, single parent homes with their mothers. They don't have any father in the home, and they're desperate for some sort of, fatherly discipline and guidance. And it just is too much big mother all around. And you get it in the schools with their teachers, you get it in society and culture, and you get it at home. And where's the dad? Where's the dad? Well, mom probably kicked them out. So something went wrong for sure. So they have these Jesus shirts on, and they're looking for a father figure. But ultimately, Jesus is a friend, you see. And so they have a problem seeing Jesus as this father figure. They try to make a god, an idol sort of out of Jesus, as someone to follow, like a parent. But Jesus, again, his farewell discourse was to say, "See me as I see you as a friend. See me as a friend." Not as some big shot Lord of Lord, King of Kings on a throne, etc., stuff like that. Those are comes from those who are desperate for some father-like, figure in their lives and guidance. And you see it. You see people who go bad. Always, someone told me, who was it? Someone who knew about this. They say, hey, father's divorce. Father's not at home. Yeah, and they say, ah, see it all the time. It was some sort of, who was that? Said social worker, somebody who knew about all this. He says, yeah, that's, you see it all the time, that especially young men go, and women, they go wild because they don't have a father in the house, father figure. And of course, we're told by the New World Order that fathers aren't necessary, that women can do it all, and two women raising a kid, that's like even better. We don't need men, they say. We don't need men for, what are the good men needed for? Maybe changing a light bulb or setting the clocks at daylight savings time or a few other things, but other than that, pretty much just bring home as much money as you can so they can go shopping, but shopping for new homes or whatever they shop for. But no, they don't need men. This is the whole gestalt, the whole zeitgeist of the times, the whole thing about, men are superfluous, basically. So, but with this attitude is, you end up not being able to relate with Jesus as a friend, as an equal, because you don't, didn't have a dad. You want someone you can look up to like you're a little kid, and you want to see your dad as just this all-powerful, all-knowing being, in your life. That's what you're looking for. So that's a problem. That's a problem. Now, I did have a dad, and he was great in not going along with the mainstream, with swimming against the current. He's outstanding at that. Absolutely outstanding. Also very wise, very talented. And I got a lot of reinforcement, even though we had our problems, to say the least, because I felt that, I was more tuned in. I was tuned into the return of Jesus. I knew it was going to happen. I was came into the world knowing about all this. I knew A Course in Miracles was going to be published before it was. I was aware. I didn't know the name of it, but I knew a great book by Jesus was going to be published. It's an extremely helpful spiritual work, and I said, this is going to be super important. And so, my dad wasn't aware of this. And so I came off as being some sort of smart aleck or something. He didn't like it, because I seem to brush aside his spiritual value. I said, well, it's great, it's good, but there's something even better coming. That's basically what I was saying. And he says, what do you talk? Who are you to say this kind of stuff? It's nonsense. I know these Indian gurus or these Zen masters. There's nothing better than that. And I said, well, that's a good, valid way of saying, but there is some teaching. There's some teaching that's going to come in that is, was more in tune with the times. It's going to be better. And A Course in Miracles is certainly more in tune with these times. Certainly in tune with the return of Jesus. Very important. And he wasn't into that return of Jesus. He wasn't into the Bible so much or that kind of stuff. So he got upset, angry with me, sent me to my room, said, don't come out until you apologize. And of course, I wouldn't apologize. I wouldn't come out. I just basically stayed in my room for the next 20 years or so. And because I'm not going to apologize. I'm not going to back off and say, okay, this is just a whim, and Jesus isn't coming back, I'm just making this up to be smart. I wasn't going to apologize. I said, no, I believe it. I know it's true. And I'm going to get ready for that. That's what I want to do. But in a lot of other ways, he was very iconoclastic, very willing to go against, be a trendsetter and all this kind of stuff. So I had that, good role model there, support there. Very helpful. But he still thought I was crazy. He actually said that on his deathbed. He was dying. I asked Jesus to help him out, and then he basically told the family that I was crazy. Called it crazy. So why, I don't know why he said that, but why not ask Jesus to help out if you're dying? You know, what's wrong with that? Why not ask truth consciousness to wake you up from an arrogance that you have to die? You know, why not? So I said that, I tried, at least I tried, but he didn't like that at all. That really, really bothered him. So he basically tried to undermine me by saying I was crazy to say that. And I said, well, that's too bad. But, you know, there you go. At least I tried. At least I tried. Because even at the moment of death, you can return to full health, or even after dying, you can. Look at Lazarus. I mean, Jesus raised a number of people from the dead, actually. He participated in their raising themselves from the dead, ultimately. He said, hey, Lazarus, you know, come out. And Lazarus, I guess, had decided that, you know, he was free to appear any way he wants to appear. And Jesus was there as the ringmaster to, you know, help bring this whole thing into the open. So don't get tripped up by any of this historical Jesus stuff, okay? We have it all clear here. We have it all clear. I'm not going to get tripped up by it. So don't worry about it. Yeah, we know there's two Bethanies. You know, there's one in Perea and then there's one in Judea. Right? Yeah. Near Jerusalem, actually. That's where Lazarus lived. Bethany's very near Jerusalem. And that's where Lazarus lived. And Jesus was on the east bank of Jordan River in Perea, in a place called Bethany, that's often called Bethany. So he went from there to the Bethany that was in Judea, where Lazarus lived. Yeah, it's all coming clear. So we won't be tripped up here. We won't be tripped up. We'll stay on track. We'll stay on track here. All right. Very great. There's still some time left, but didn't wear a jacket here, so it's a little nippy. It's getting quite late. It's cool in California now, actually. It's just like low 70s every day. It's supposed to rain on a few days from now. So there's no heat wave taking place here at all. The air conditioner, the fog along the coast, the marine layer, as we call it, is very strong right now. And so it's supposed to be very windy tomorrow, and things are going to be quite cool. And as long as that marine layer hangs out, it stays quite cool. And sun summers are very cool here, actually. The marine layer is like just blowing over the mountains every day, just hovers around. Other times, it's not so much. So we don't really know, you know, how that's going to go. At some level, it'll go exactly the way we want it to go, of course. Like everything in this dream, it goes exactly the way we want it to go. We just don't understand how amazing our creativity is, actually. We don't. We do not understand the creativity of the mind, how all-powerful and all-creative it is. It's simply, there's no limit to it, actually, except that it can't change reality. That's it. That's the only limitation it has. Can't change what it is. It cannot change the fact that it's unlimited. It's like pure freedom cannot change the fact that it's free. That's the only limitation it has. Okay, so, very great. We can call this one a day or not, depending on if anything else comes up. Full stop in the wow practice, full stop in the wow. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already back. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already here. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already here. That's a nice practice. Try that one. Now, if you feel like freaked out a little bit, it's just like, well, take solace, you know. What part of these videos is to reassure people as much as possible and to try to normalize it and realize I'm not freaked out, not freaked out very much at all. I've already related with Jesus, and I was nervous about it for sure. I was a little jittery nervous, but not so much. And no, I'm not freaked out. So, you know, if you can take that as sort of a helpful, you know, cue to, you might say, you know what, maybe I can calm down too. Yeah, in some practice. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already here, and he's here as my friend. Absolutely, here is a friend. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already here as a friend. Yes, I already know that Jesus is already here as my friend. And then do that, and then full stop in the wow, full stop in the wow. The wow of feeling this. So what I'm saying is you can do it. Since I've done it, you can do it too. You can greatly lessen your nervousness about it. Absolutely you can, if you just keep working at it. And it may be a mystery why you feel nervous. Sure, because it's the totality of your still the arrogance and your familiarity with your arrogance that brings it about. That you can't quite feel like yourself. You feel that there's some sort of barrier there, and I don't really feel that barrier, you know, present in me. Hardly at all, you know, but I can imagine it. If I'm imagining some other someone else, I can see, I can feel how there'd be a barrier there, where you'd feel just like I just don't feel comfortable. It's like if you're around some VIP or celebrity, I just don't feel like I can, I don't want to bother them. I don't want to, you know, just there's something there. You can't relate to them as a friend, so to speak. So it's like you can't really put your finger on why you feel that way. So what I say is you simply have to keep practicing and evaporating the continuity fear. It's the totality of your arrogance that brings this about. And so the more you evaporate your continuity fear, the more you repent, that all lightens up. It just lightens up like the way fog burns off. It burns off like fog burning off, a mist burning off. And gradually you just feel like, I just don't feel so, like there's such a barrier there anymore. I don't feel so like a celebrity's there. I don't feel celebrity consciousness. I feel more relaxed, like more like friend consciousness than celebrity consciousness kind of thing. So it's sort of a gradual, subtle sort of situation. You can't really put your finger on any one particular cause of it. You just have to keep working on these various angles, which we've been doing in these videos, and reducing the overall, you know, nervousness about it. And one of the best ways is to say, okay, just say Jesus is here, and just full stop on the wow. Just go in the neutral, neither advancing nor retreating. And just put all your will into that and see if you could just stay just still like this and not do anything one way or the other, not react one way or the other, just full stop on the wow. Practice that. And the more you practice that, that's a very rapid way to approach it. Because you have this discipline then, and you know if you start getting this feeling jittery, you can go right into the wow. Even if Jesus is right here, you can go right into the wow and insist upon it, and you have the discipline to do it. You don't have to be deer in headlights. You see, so practicing full stop in the wow is an extremely helpful way to prepare. And that's what I've done. I said, what if Jesus walks up right now? Well, I'm just going to keep sitting here, you know. I'm just going to keep sitting here because I'm practicing. Practice comes first. Practice is most important. Full stop in the wow. And when I can come out of the wow of it, you know, then we'll take it from there. But I'm not going to anticipate one way or the other. I'm in neutral. I'm not frozen. I'm intentionally neutral. I'm not deer in headlights. I'm intentionally neutral. I'm very poised and aware that I'm in this neutral. I'm doing it using my will to neither advance nor retreat. See, that's not deer in headlights. Deer in headlights is a whole different thing. You're like paralyzed in a trance state, and you're not. It's very different. This is not a fear state. This is a mixture of elation and trepidation that you recognize consciously and understand this is a normal reaction and it will dissipate. So you're holding yourself there, neither advancing or retreating. So that's very important. So yes, I already know that Jesus is already here as a friend. And you can say, yes, I already know that I'm already ready to relate to Jesus as a friend. Yes, I already know that I am already ready to relate with Jesus as a friend. Yes, I already know that we're, Jesus and I, we're friends. We're friends, that's it. Yes, I already know that I'm already ready to relate with Jesus as a friend. So try practicing these. It's not too early to do that. It's absolutely the right time to start practicing this way. Yes, I already know that I'm already ready to relate with Jesus as a friend. There's that song, Me and Jesus. Me and Jesus. We got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got it all worked out. Me and Jesus. See. We got a good thing going. We don't need to tell anybody what it's all about. Yeah, Jesus brought me through all of my troubles. Jesus brought me through all my trials. Jesus brought me through all my heartaches. And I don't need to, see. I don't need anybody to tell me what it's all about. See, I don't need anybody to tell me what it's all about. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. I've already been through all these troubles and trials. So I know that my Jesus ain't going to forsake me now. Yeah, that's another part of the song. Just as a friend. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. So this is using the already potent practice of already-ness, which is a very high practice. It's one of the highest practices, for instance, in Radical Dzogchen teaching. And the Holy Spirit recommended to me, starting January 1st of this year, use this already practice. It's very, very potent. Jesus recommends it in Journey Beyond Words. Use this already practice. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. Now, and the priest in the mass, Catholic mass, he asked, what about Christianity is different than other religions? And someone said, well, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He said, yeah. Now this is a very valid point that we're taught that we're supposed to develop a personal relationship with Jesus and that we should be friends with Jesus. That's very important. That's what John said, Jesus said in the farewell address reported by John, the Apostle John, which apparently was the first apostle that Jesus called. Had a fairly good view, seems like, fairly better than most take on it all. I don't know if John actually had it, you know, entirely clear. but he seemed to get some of it. And Jesus said, hey, I got to speak in parables to all of you. You know, it's in later on, I can speak directly. But right now, it's a tough test sledding here. So me and Jesus, we got it all worked out. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. And imagine this is true. Yes, I know me and Jesus were already friends and insist upon it. No, we're already friends. This is it. Burn that into your consciousness. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. See it that way, see it that way, see it that way. I always objected to those who called Jesus, Lord, 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 King, King, Savior, Lord, God, God, God. They're trying to distance themselves as Jesus is some, greatly above them, and that we're nothing, and we're just these wretched humans, and Jesus is this divine being, and we're, I always greatly objected to that. Greatly objected to it. Yeah, because that's not what Jesus taught us at all. He says, I see you now as friends. That is my final testament, my farewell testament to you. So be friends to one another too, in memory of me. And someday you'll realize that we are all equal. We're all friends. So yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already friends. And you can say, yes, I know that Jesus and I are already friends, if you want to be make your grammar teacher happy. But I say me and Jesus, referencing this song by Tom T. Hall, wrote the song. Various people have recorded it. George Jones recorded it. A very nice rendition of it. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got all worked out. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about. Jesus brought me through all of my troubles. Jesus brought me through all of my trials. Jesus brought me through all my heartaches, and I know my Jesus ain't going to forsake me now. Something like that. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got it all worked out. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about. I know a man who once was a sinner. I knew a man, something like that. Once was a drunk. I know a man who once was a loser. He went out one day and made an altar out of a stump. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got it worked out. It goes like that. So I know a man who once was a loser. I know a man who once was a drunk. I know a man who once was a sinner. He went out one day and made an altar out of a stump. Jesus got a lot of poor people out doing his work. Me and Jesus, we got all worked out. Yeah. Yeah, I'm a poor person, believe it or not. Absolutely. So ridiculously poor. In this society, it's terrifying. I mean, it's suicidal to not have any money. And every day, I'm terrified that the next day something's going to break and I won't be able to replace it. So I'm just living feeling like almost, just on the edge of thinnest of ice. So I'm very, very, very poor, actually. I camouflage it because I don't want anybody knowing that. But, so, Jesus has got a lot of poor people out doing his work. This is very true. He might be one of them. Don't think it's just the wealth, some wealth. You have to be wealthy to do it. Absolutely not. Of course, that rich person was in Perea. The Decapolis, the young rich king, and he said, Jesus, what do I need to do to follow you? And he said, go give everything away and follow me. He says, I can't do that. I got too much wealth, too many investments, too many things. There's no way I can do it. It's not possible for me. Where, like in my case, what do I have to give up? Don't have anything really. I don't know what. I've already given up my golf clubs, basically. I don't even play anymore. I can't be out playing when I know I got to be taping like this, and giving it everything I got. I think I've maybe gone once or twice in the last year and a half. So I spent like $25 on golf in the last year and a half. That's about as much I can afford. So, not exactly living the life of Riley anymore, which is fine. It's fine because Jesus is back. That's way more important. So, practice, practice, practice. Yes, I know that Jesus, I already know that Jesus and I are already, Jesus and me and Jesus are already great friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus are, we're already great friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus are already great friends. Now, maybe a lot of Christians are really far along on this. It's quite possible. I wouldn't be surprised. They tend to have a personal relationship with Jesus. And they tend to feel it very strongly. And so, you know, I hope so. I hope so. Although some of the things they say make me wonder about, you know, so it's like, because a lot of it seems to be the logic of arrogance as far as, you know, sacrificial stuff and all these kinds of things. So we'll see, but hopefully they are far along. I certainly hope so. So me and Jesus, yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already great friends. Yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already great friends. And yes, I already know that me and Jesus were already great friends. Yes, I do already know that me and Jesus, we are already great friends. Long lost friends, wonderful friends. Imagine meeting a long-lost friend, a friend you haven't seen for a long time. Just how that feels. It's easy, isn't it? If you meet a friend you haven't seen for a long time before and you were friends before, you just sit right down and you just start right up where you left off years ago, oftentimes, if you were good friends. Still have the same sense of humor, you know, and everything just goes easily. That's great. That's why friends are great. I don't have any worldly friends, so to speak, because I've been focusing on friendship with Jesus. You know, I have to get ready for that, because that's what's really important, to help, you know, bring others to friendship with Jesus and help realize this is where it's at. This is where it's at now. So, me and Jesus, you already know that me and Jesus were already great friends. Absolutely, hallelujah. This is probably it now. We're just about at, we did it, the full video. Great.